Tim, toward in your presentation, you mentioned the notion of an insurance archaeologist. Now, what would an insurance archaeologist be, and why would I be interested, or why would somebody be interested in retaining one?
So an insurance archaeologist normally is an organization with expertise in assisting companies in identifying and utilizing legacy insurance policies. And I think the easiest way that I can explain this for the audience is to consider the perspective of someone who is at a company that's been acquired, or they're new, or there's been a management turnover, and you know by instinct, by what you've learned at the company, that you had coverage, you certainly had insurance coverage dating back, let's say, to the 1960s or 50s, but in the transition from paper to electronic and movement around, sale of assets, et cetera, no one knows where it is. And there are a number of very sophisticated vehicles that an insurance archaeologist can utilize to ensure that you maximize your contractual rights under previously existing insurance policies, everything from investigating in-house at your company to looking for external sources, not just from insurance carriers, but from registrations with states and other sources. And these can really be night or day types of financial impact findings for your entity. And if anyone would like to have further information on the archaeologists or I don't want to promote one over the other, but if anyone would like to follow up with the telephone call, I'm happy to direct them towards some of the firms that provide that service.
Thank you so much. And Mark, a quick question for you from our audience. Now, you touched upon some strategies and what have you. Now, do you see any strategies that you find working potentially across every jurisdiction, or is it truly a jurisdiction by jurisdiction approach that you need to take when developing your strategy, and perhaps some best practice you could share about generating a strategy?
Yeah, I think the issues are, my strategies that I recommend should work or could be attempted to work across every jurisdiction. But as I stated during the presentation, the listener or the practitioner is going to know their judges and their system the best. The attempt to bring order to chaos only works if everybody involved in the process wants to bring the order. If you've got a state court judge or even a federal court judge that says, you know what, I understand that there might be other cases across the country, I don't have to worry about those, I have to worry about the ones on my docket, then that judge may not be as amenable to either working, coordinating with other benches across the country, or putting in orders that will help the defendant orderly administrate the multiple cases across the country in different jurisdictions. That's the case where you hope that judge is not the most powerful judge you're in front of, and you might have to find the most powerful judge, in this case, or usually the federal court judge or the judge running the MDL, and have that judge essentially set the ground rules for everybody else, saying, here's a federal court order, and this will take care of the issue. That way, a state court judge, while they may be disgruntled, won't have much authority or power to do anything to you. Now, again, I was in a case where one time a state court judge said on the record something disparaging about the federal court judge, and the federal court judge read that transcript and commented back about the state court judge's comment. The goal is to not put the benches against each other. The goal is to hopefully get judges talking off the record or to each other so that they're all working in harmony.